طيب، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Today we are in a chapter of testimony. We still talk about judgment, القضاء, about judging between people. And one of the very important matter is الشهاده. What does it mean, الشهاده? Testimony. You see, the word الشهاده, it's come or derived from the Arabic verb شهده وشهده. That means he was there at present, you know, when something happened. Also, it's mean watch, نعم, or see. Which means, you see, that you are there when events happened, and it was seen by you, heard by you, that you are aware of what's going on. All this meaning, it's come in the word shahada. Why? Because when we talk about shahada, we are talking about visible, seen, and this is why we said that the word are either عالم الغيب أو عالم الشهادة. نعم، عالم الغيب, the word of seen or unseen. And Allah سبحانه وتعالى is what? عالمو. Be careful between عالم وعالمو. عالم الغيب والشهادة فلا يطلع على غيبه أحد. So Allah عز وجل is the knowing of whom, of what? The word of the seen and the unseen. So this is just background for the word shahida. So when we said shahada, that's mean testimony or testify. As I'm there, I am sure. And from this, when we say ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, I be a witness that there is none word to be worshipped except Allah. So this is a matter of what? When you say ashhadu, it's not a matter just, it's like you are seeing this fact with your eyes and feel it and live with it. So this is the word here, ashhadu. I have no doubt, like something that I look at it. Wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah also. I bear witness or I testify that there is only one God, or the only true God that worth to be worshipped is Allah Azza wa Jal, and that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is his messenger. طيب. So also sometimes it's شاهد. نعم, شاهد means watch, watching. So watching TV, they call it مشاهدة التلفزيون. Watching TV, مشاهدة. نعم, مشهد. نعم, or مشاهد, places where people go to see. نعم, طيب. And all come from the same root. So when we say الشهادة here means testimony. That person testify and tell about what he saw, what he hear, what he is knowing. And then he will be considered as shahid. Shahid means, witness. طيب. قال عز وجل فاستشهدوا شهيدين من رجالكم. نعم. فإن لم يكن رجلين فرجل ومرأتان. Call for witness when you write document about your loan or about your debt. فاستشهدوا شهيدين. You look. استشهدوا, this means ask, for somebody to testify. نعم. So this, the word all come from one root. And this is the beauty of the Arabic language. SubhanAllah. This is the only, maybe find it in Arabic language. Unique. From one word, it includes many meanings. It depends on how you use the word from the root. So it is شهد, شاهد, مشاهد, مشاهد, مشهود, شهيد, شهود. All it's come from the same root. طيب. So today is about testimony. And here in Arabic refers to seeing. Seeing, as we said, since the witness informs about what he, she has already seen and known. It is a controversial matter among scholars whether the witness should begin his or her testimony with the saying, I testify or not. Now here, a point where ulama, they have different view. Now, why the Sheikh mentioned this? Because here we are talking about somebody who is giving his testimony. So the question is it must on him to use the exact word literally? You know, when he said, Ashhadu, same like when we say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu Muhammad Rasulullah, he said, Ashhadu that this man, he has right. Ashhadu, I testify. Or I testify that this one did this or that. Is it necessary to say I testify or it's not? Or just say I saw or I know or I hear or I was there when this happened? So using the word itself, testify, when you are giving your testimony is an area of what? Huh? Of differences and controversial among some scholars. And this is what the Sheikh he started with. So he said, like saying, I have testified or not. In this regard, there are two views. The first is the well-known view maintained by the Hanbali scholars. That's mean maintained by Muslim. يعني in the Madhab al-Hanbali, Madhab al-Hanbali, the Hanbali school of fiqh. You know that there is four madahib. So this is one that they said it is should be used. طيب. Namely, that it is obligatory to say such word when testifying. That's mean in this school of thought or fiqh, which is a Hanbali, they said when somebody come to the court to testify about something, he should start by what? By saying what? Ashhadu. I testify. Naam? Like for example, it's not enough to say when they ask you, okay, you came to be witness that this man is a brother, for example, for this woman, because he's a guardian. It's not enough to say, yes, I know him, or I know that he is like this. According to this view, he said, I ashhadu bi anna, huh? Ashhadu, I testify that this, etc. So this is the point here. طيب. The second is one of the views reported to be maintained by Imam Ahmad and a group of scholars. Maybe you are surprised. You said, how come in the Hanbali say this? And then you will find Imam Ahmad, who is considered as the founder of this madhab, he said something different.
Yeah, that's why I'm confused.
Nah, this is not confusing. Why? Because you see, this to show you how much our scholars, our ulama, they don't stick to their own personal view. So sometimes they say with certain view, and after investigation or finding new evidences, they may move with that, with what? With the proof they found. So they will not stick. They say, no, you know, I say this and people follow me, you know, through this. How come I change? No, because those scholars, they are not looking for the pleasure of what? Of people. They know that this is amana, this is trust. They don't care what people think. The important thing that they should follow what? The truth. Like Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah, when he was in Iraq, he have a madhab, okay? Many of this idea that he has in Iraq, when he moved to Egypt, it was changed. So sometimes in the same madhab, you will find more than different view. Like for example, in madhab Hanbali sometimes you will find among the scholars who are following this madhab sometimes they adopt the view which was adopted by the Shafi'i or by the Maliki or by other madhab نعم like مثلا الإمام أبو حنيفة this to show you what علماء is looking for is what to make sure that whatever you know view they adopt or opinion they adopted it should be based on the دليل and proofs you remember when we study at Hajj that for example in the as one example remind you about this and the madhab Hanbali for example they said أشهر الحج what is it أشهر الحج ذو القعدة وذو الحجة وعشر ذو القعدة وعشر من ذو الحجة شوال وذو القعدة and 10 days of ذو الحجة this is their view الإمام أبو بن عثيمين and some of the scholars of the madhab Hanbali now they said no they follow what الإمام مالك or شافعي said that it should be the whole month is considered as month of Hajj. Sorry, you know, to dig deep in this point, you know, and take more longer time. But this is very, very important point that teach us that we should not just stick to any view if we found dalil or proof which support other view. This is the way, and this is why the ulama said, for students of knowledge like yourself who are studying and you know attending you know lessons with the ulama and the teachers and they study it's not enough for them to follow one madhab they should follow what the dalil the madhab is for whom for the general public you know people ordinary people they don't have so they said it's okay to follow a certain view and this is why my dear brothers it's not an Islamic way that everybody just loyal to his madhab and you know make himself like a different party from other school this is unfortunately what's happened before and this what was divided the Muslim ummah that you cannot imagine that you know if you look at a picture for al-haram Mecca al-haram before you know the start of the kingdom at time Umar al-Aziz before they have four places for prayer for imams and every madhab they pray alone the Hanafi pray alone the Maliki alone and there's imam for astaghfirullah so it is very important to know that unity is the most important goal for a Muslim this is why Allah Azza wa Jalla said واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا طيب so anyway go back return to our subject so here we have two different view that one of them by the Hanbali in general and the other one was taken also adopted by Imam Ahmad and group scholars They maintain that it is not obligatory to begin one's testimony with saying, I testify or the like. So we have two different views here. This is the same opinion adopted by Al-Imam Taqiyuddin ibn Taymiyyah and his student Ibn al-Qayyim. Also they say also the same view that it's not necessary to say it. Why? Because they said there is no dalil that the one should say this word exactly. It's not like when you talk about shahadat an la ilaha illallah na Muhammad Rasulullah. This is different. Because there is dalil. Man shahida an la ilaha illallah. But for testimony, just you know, when you go to the court or somebody asks you to testify with him, there's no dalil, according to those ulama, that say the one should start his testimony by saying, I testify. Let's read what Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah said. He said, it is not request of testimony to say I testify. This is the same opinion adopted by Imam Ahmad and others. And it has not come to my knowledge that there is a contrary legal text in his in this concern. That means no dalil that contradict with this view. None of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the companion successors, at-tabi'in, has stipulated saying such word when testifying. طيب, Ibn al-Qayyim added what? He said, according to the sound view of majority of Muslim ulama, in this regard, informing about what one has witnessed is in fact a testimony that is to say what he has witnessed. So that means he is telling of what he saw. He is telling of what he hear. He is telling of what he is knowing. طيب. That is to say, it is not a condition for the validity of testimony to say, I testify. Rather, whenever the witness says that he has seen such and such a thing, or that he has heard such and such a thing, and the like, this is regarded as a valid testimony. طيب. In addition, there is no text either in the Quran or the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That means there is no dalil from the Quran or the Hadith, the Sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, which say that one should say, I testify. طيب. That the witness is to say, I testify when bearing testimony. Furthermore, none of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have stipulated saying so when testifying, nor can it be concluded by means of analytical deductions. That's mean qiyas. Al-qiyas. This is the fourth source of legislation in Sharia. Naam? You know what are the sources for Sharia? Rules for Sharia, what are they? القرآن الكريم والسنة والإجماع والقياس four sources and the قياس and إجماع based on the original sources which is القرآن والسنة the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم إن شاء الله maybe إن شاء الله in the future we have a class about the foundation of fiqh وصول الفقه in this such class you know the meaning how the علماء use دليل in different situation. طيب. Further the numerous proofs of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and the statements of the companion and the Arabic language assert that it is not required to say such word when testifying. This is something that was not needed. طيب. So it is a collective duty. Now we move to another point here. Is giving testimony, is it must, is it duty or optional?
Duty.
Huh? Duty in whom?
Personal
sin. No. Collective duty. If there's group of people, not all of them that we call, for example, 20 or 50 people, they were there. Should we have called all of them for testimony or just a few of them? So this is why he said it's collective duty. What's the meaning of collective duty?
Huh?
Fardu kifaya. Fardu kifaya. Now, be careful about this. We have two types of duty. Fardu ayn or fardu kifaya. Be careful. Fardu ayn. Individual responsibility. And everyone, we say like, for example, as-salatu Fardu Ayn. Salah is required from every single Muslim. That means if somebody pray in his behalf, it will not be accepted. So this is Fardu Ayn. Fardu Kifaya. Huh? Like Salatul Janaza, for example, or Salatul Kusuf, or any. If a group of people, of the Muslim, they did it, then it's not required by others. But if all of them, they didn't, all of them are committing sin. Like Salatul Janazah. If there is a Muslim, and everybody said, I'm not going to pray. Salatul Janazah. All of them who are there, they will be committing sin because none of them did this duty. But if a group of them, and some days that I'm busy, today I cannot come, I have work, and the rest they are there, then the one who left is what? Excuse. Clear? طيب. It is a collective duty to undertake testimony in a matter other than limits set by Allah exalted. That is to say, if someone assumes the responsibility of testifying, it becomes sufficient and the rest of the Muslims are not be accountable, since the purpose of testimony has been accomplished. The important thing that we accomplish what? Okay. The goal. It was accomplished by few, then that's okay. It's not like, for example, if many people they saw the Hilal for Ramadan. Do we have to call everyone who sights in the moon for court to testify? All what we need, only one or two, maybe. خلاص? طيب. If there is only one person to do so, then it is personally obligatory upon him. طيب. In that situation, there was only one man or woman, a person who knows this fact, then it is must on him to report his testimony, his shahada. Let's say, for example, and this happened, when ladies, they nurse a baby of other women. This happened, you know, in Muslim community before they get this types of milk, which is dry milk. Your people, they were in the community, like, you know, in the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, who's the one who nursed the Prophet ﷺ? He didn't, Halima al-Sa'diyya. So this is something that was a practice. And even till, recent, here in this country, and I'm sure that in many rural, area, they do this. So when the baby is, they are neighbor, and then the baby was crying, and his mother is not busy or she cannot feed him, then there will another woman. Right? This sometimes no one know it except one woman. The one who gave her breast to this baby. So she know how many people she feed it, right or not? Right. So in the future, if she know that a young man asked for the hand, for marriage, another woman, and she know that she feed both of them, the boy and the girl, when they were baby, no one else know this except her, then she should speak out and give her testimony before they get married. And this, my dear brother, this is an answer for many people who say, why Islam accept the testimony of one man, equal for two women? Here, you will find that we accept the testimony of one lady, and there is no other situation where the testimony of one person is accepted. Always, when a matter of men, there should be how many? Two. But when it's come here, one lady, one woman testimony will be taken in account. This is an answer, good answer that you gave for somebody tell you, Islam, why do you think about lady, you give two men for witnesses, or one man equal for two women? They don't understand the whole picture, the whole situation. This is why, my dear brothers, Islam was not or misunderstood by many people, even among Muslims, because they don't look to the whole picture, the whole system. They take one part out of the system and then they put it, and they look at it and they try to judge it and evaluate it. They took it out of what they call it context. So this is why here, so if there is a woman, like in this situation, then is it must on her to give her testimony or not? It is must, obligatory. If she conceal or hide this testimony, she is committing sin. And it's not an easy sin. because she let brother and sister they get married. طيب in consideration with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and let not the witness refuse when they are called upon. It is must in a Muslim. Like for example, if you are in a situation and you know you were the only one who can help the victim to take his right from the one who assaulted him or he took his money or whatever. It's not for you to say, well, that's not my business. Because when this, you go to the court, you say, I will ask him, is there any witnesses? He says, for example, there's Ibrahim. Then they will call Ibrahim. Ibrahim, you are there? He was there? If he's there, then he have to tell what he saw. It is must on him. There is many details, you know. Well, it's not place here to discuss it. Depends on certain, you know, circumstances. But generally speaking, here it is must on the one that who, you know, witnesses anything that he should give his testimony, even against his own family. Subhanallah. And this is the only thing in all law. In the whole world, you never find a religion or deen that command you to say the truth even against your son, brother, father, or even against yourself. وَلَا تَكْتُمُ الشَّهَادَةِ. طيب. That is, they are to offer the testimony. The general meaning of the verse imply both assuming the responsibility of testifying and offering the testimony itself. According to Ibn Abbas and radiallahu anhuma and others, the above mentioned verse means assuming the responsibility of testifying and declaring testimony in front of judge or court, deliberative body or those in authority. That means whenever you were asked to give your testimony in any formal situation, then you should not hesitate and should give it. Since necessity requires legal testimony for confirming the rights of people and the concluded contracts, testifying becomes an obligation like enjoining what is right and forbidding what is wrong. Same like al-amr bil-ma'roof wal-na'an al-munkar. When we say al-amr bil-ma'roof, al-ma'roof, what is it? When you say al-amr bil-ma'roof, that means you enjoying the right. So now if you saw something which is wrong, somebody is taking the money or something that belongs to somebody else, what is the ma'ruf here? The ma'ruf that you should support the victim to return to him his rights. Especially the Prophet ﷺ said, also akhaka zaliman aw mazluman. You should support and help your brother, you know, in all situations. Now, as for declaring testimony, it is an individual duty on whomever undertakes it and is asked to testify in consideration of what Allah Azza wa Jal subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the meaning, and do not conceal testimony. وَلَا تَكْتُمُ الشَّهَادَةِ, for whoever conceal it, his heart is indeed sinful. وَلَا تَكْتُمُ الشَّهَادَةِ وَمَنْ يَكْتُمُهَا فَإِنَّهُ آثِمٌ قَلْبُ. This is Surah Al-Baqarah. طيب. That is, when one is asked to testify of what one has witnessed, one is not to conceal testimony nor overstate in declaring it. What mean overstate? Just tell what you saw. Don't give your opinion. Huh? Your view. He hit him. I think he hate him. Nobody ask you. The testimony is what? About what? What did you see? That's it. سبحان الله لقطة الشريعة كده very precise. طيب one is not to conceal testimony nor overstate in the claim since Allah عز وجل said for whoever conceal it ها ومن يكتم فإنه آثم قلبه that is to say the heart of the one concealing testimony is wicked a server diving threat Allah عز وجل here threatening them turning one's heart into wicked disfigure that means the one who concealed the shahada this may Allah عز وجل affect his heart because his heart was not clear he's afraid of people more than afraid of whom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so that means his heart is already what contaminated and this also this is a proof my dear brothers that how much sin affects the heart This is what Allah Azza wa Jalla said in Surah Al-Mutaffifin. كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ Anyone who do any or commit any sin, no matter how light, small is it, what happened? His heart will be covered with this sin. And this was this ayah was explained by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in a hadith. إذا أذنب العبد نكتة في قلبه نكتة سوداء when a servant نعم commits any sin then one black dot it will be marked on his heart if he gave up retained repented it will be what wiped raised clear but if he continue with other sin that's mean another black dot. So what will happen if every time, just imagine yourself you are holding a pen, black pen, on a beige, white pen, and just going, what will happen? To return to what? Yeah. To black changes. The same thing for the heart. So my dear brothers, I remind myself and remind you and everyone that don't underestimate a sin no matter how you think it is very, very small, very simple. Don't underestimate it. This is why some of the ulama they said, "La صغيرة, la كبيرة, la صغيرة مع الإصرار, ولا كبيرة مع الاستغفار." La صغيرة does mean don't. There is nothing which is considered, you know, as small or tiny. With determination to do it and repeat it again and again and again, then it's not tiny anymore. It is what? It's become major. طيب the above verse signifies that testifying is an individual duty open whoever witness an event whenever he she asked to testify the great scholar Ibn al-Qayyim rahmatullahi alayhi says undertaking and declaring testimony are an obligation the non-performance of which is a sin. The one who not do it will be considered as sin. He added, by means of analogous deduction. Now the Sheikh is using al-qiyas here, using al-qiyas of the view maintained by the Hanbali scholars in this concern. If a witness conceal his testimony, refuses to undertake or declare testimony concerning any right, he is to redress. This right in the form of fine. This is because he has been able to give the right to whom it is due by declaring testimony, but refrained. So he didn't help the one who is in need for his testimony by getting his right. Why? Because he didn't tell or declare his shahada. It is as an if one had the opportunity to save a person from dangerous situation yet one has not done so you see the al-qiyas here analogical deduction al-qiyas here the sheikh saying the one who doesn't give his testimony will cause harm for this victim by not helping him to get his right As the same if you are seeing somebody sinking in the sea or in the ocean or falling down and maybe he's dying and you didn't save his life. So the same thing. While we know that saving life is very important. Right. If there is no harm on the side of the witness because of the claim of testimony. This is now here, start with what?
Condition.
With the condition here. Because sometimes maybe the testimony will lead to what? Destruction. Maybe if he say this word, he will be executed. Right. If there is no harm on the side of the witness because of the claim of testimony, it then becomes obligatory open him to testify. However, if testimony will cause harm to him personally or to his sense of honor, propriety or family, in this case it is not obligatory open him. Look to the mercy of the of the Sharia. Right. This based on what? Who can tell me? General rule in Islam, general guideline. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. نعم. طيب. The meaning of the, let no scribe be harmed or any witness. This also سورة البقرة. لا يضار شاهد ولا كاتب ولا شهيد. لا يضار كاتب ولا شهيد. This is an ayat الدين. The verse which is and the not the last page of Surah Al-Baqarah, the one before the last page. The whole page was about Ayat Al-Mudayin, one verse. This is the longest verse in the Quran about debt. وَلَا يُضَارُ كَاتِبٌ وَلَا شَهِيدٌ. No one scribe, the one who's writing, nor the witness, the one who testify, should be harmed because of what they're doing. طيب. It is, this is also demonstrated in the Hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Says, one should not harm another, others, nor should he seek benefits for himself by causing harm to others. So we should not put ourselves in front of others here. So the witness must be certain about the matter concerning which he is to testify. This is another condition that he should be what? Sure, certain. Not well, I think. I not sure. But I think so. None of this world. If you are not firm and you are not certain, then you should not say. They will ask you, is this man who killed this victim? It was dark, but he looks like him. No. Okay, if you are not sure, you should not testify. So this should be certain. طيب. It is prohibited for the witness to testify to having witnessed anything except what she knows with certainty by seeing or hearing, for example. Did you see it? Did you hear it? You was there. This is the way that you give your testimony. In consideration to what Allah Azza wa Jal said, the meaning, and do not purse that of which you have no knowledge. وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ. طيب, this is Surah Al-Isra. وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرُ وَالْفُؤَادُ كُلُّ أُولَئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْؤُولًا. طيب, the other ayah, the meaning, but only those who testify to the truth can benefit, and they know. That is, the witness must be wholly certain regarding what she is to testify. In this connection, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said, when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was asked about testimony, he said to the inquirer, do you see the sun? Do you see the sun? The man replied in the affirmative. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, so testify like this or leave it. Testify like this or leave it. That means Do you see the sun? Is it clear to you? He said, yes. He said, okay. Testify like the situation when you are seeing the sun. That means you saw what you did. So, same as you are seeing the sun. That means very, very clear, no doubt about it. طيب. He, alayhi salatu wasalam, then said, so testify like this or leave it. Which means that should be certain. This narration is related by Al-Khalal in his book entitled Al-Ijma', the collection. Al-Ijma', this is one other book also talk about Ijma' for them. Al-Jami'. Al-Bayhaqi says, this narration is not narrated by a reliable chain of transmitter. Now this is, you know, something that we study where? In the science of hadith. That means some ulama, they said this hadith narration is not that strong. But look to the answer of Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar. However, Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar says, commenting on this hadith, but the meaning of the hadith stated in this narration is correct. The meaning is correct. Why it is correct? Because it's supported by other dalil, other proofs in the Quran, the Sunnah. To illustrate, knowledge about the matter regarding which one is to testify should be based either open hearing or open seeing it. So, two things. Either something that you saw or something that you hear. Thereby, one is not to testify to having witnessed anything except what one knows with certainty by way of seeing or hearing, or through hearing about an issue which is public even discussed among people and which is difficult to know except in this way. As in cases like relationship by marriage, this is the one that we talk about, and death of a person. However, one is not to offer testimony depending upon hearing about an issue discussed among people except when it's come to one's knowledge through number of people enough to prove the certainty of such matter. That means if somebody told you that, you know, Ibrahim, he is the brother of Shamshul. Unless there are group of people that you report that you hear it from many people, because they are testify, and you are what transmitting their testimony, then you should not testify. Because maybe this one has a doubt. This is why he said, if something which is known, like relationship, people, they know that this man from this family, this woman married to so and so, this daughter, مثلاً, belong to this family, and likewise. There are six conditions to be fulfilled by the one who is to deliver testimony. Now look at these six conditions, and in fact it is like a summary for what we just said. Should be adult, reaching puberty. So the minor, young child, his testimony will not be taken in account. So testimony is not acceptable from children except when it's concerned matters relating to them. Relating to them. In this concern, the great scholar Ibn al-Qayyim said, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the Fuqaha of Medina used to accept the testimony of children when it is related to quarrel occurring among them, between kids, between them. Then you accept their testimony. This is... Take it. This is because men are not typically present at such situation. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum. So when we have, for example, children are fighting between themselves, their children, you know, when they are playing, they fight among themselves, and no adult is present there. So when you come to investigate, who will tell you what happened? Huh? Children. Therefore, in this situation, it is okay to accept their testimony. Right? So this is something which is related to children. طيب. People's rights would be lost. Unfulfilled and thus disregarded, especially when their testimony is more probable to truthful or reliability truthfully. This is as in cases such as when they come directly without going to their homes to testify to an incident they have witnessed, agree on the same information and are separated of the time delivering the testimony. طيب next point, I think this point very clear. Sanity, does mean he is sane, because if he's mad, if he's crazy, something, you know, you cannot take his word. Testimony of the insane of the or the foolish person is not accepted or acceptable. As for the one who sometimes lose consciousness, his testimony is acceptable when he regain consciousness and assume the responsibility of testifying. Some people, you know, they come, what they call it, sar, you know, sar. You know, some people, they had, it's like extra electricity in their brain, so they lose consciousness. So at the time when they lose consciousness, this, it will not be taken. But if they are normal, then it's okay. طيب. The ability to speak. The testimony of the mute is not acceptable, even his signs and gesture are understandable. Why? Naam, because it could be there is a chance, maybe 1% that they did not get what he means. Since certainty be fulfilled in testimony. The signs of the mute, in spite of that, are effective and sufficient, is ruling pertaining to his affairs, such as marriage and divorce. This is okay, because this is something that's personal. For necessity, when it is a matter of what? Of necessity. However, if such person write his testimony, it is then acceptable. Why? Because writing is like speaking. He can declare what he has in mind. But to say do with his, you know, gesture may not be understood by others, you know, in the right way. طيب. For being a Muslim, and you know this is very important, because all a Muslim consider as adil, just because he fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a matter which is very, very sensitive. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, break two just men from among yourself, or among you. Rajulayni. Thus, the testimony of disbeliever is unacceptable except when being witness to a will at the time. What's mean here? Somebody is dying. And he was troubling. And all people around him were non-Muslim, like he was in a plane or... And before he died, he thought that he's going to die. So he told them, look, you know, the house that I live in belong to Hassan or to Abdullah. Please inform them. Then if they are informed about this, then it will be what? It will be considered. After investigation about their background. This was mentioned in the Quran, by the way. This mentioned... This is mentioned in the Quran about such type. This is Surah Al-Ma'idah. Allah Azza wa Jalla said the meaning, O you who have believed, testimony should be taken among you when death approach one of you at the time of bequest, that of two just men from among you or two others from outside of you, which means non-Muslim. If you are traveling through the land and the disaster of death should strike you. طيب. How long of time we have? طيب. They didn't make an answer. طيب. Maybe I'll pass some of the comments of طيب. Having good memory. Also, the one who given testimony should have good memory, doesn't forget what he saw or what he hear. What you hear this? Yes. What you? I forget. I try to remember. No, he should have good memory to tell what he saw, because this is right. So the testimony of foolish or forgetful person is not acceptable, since it is known that such a person makes many mistakes and usually forgets. If it was known that you always make mistakes and always forget, then how can you depend on him? And because he is unreliable in telling the truth. Besides, whatever he says is thought to be incorrect, since it may be one of his mistakes. Yet, testimony is acceptable from the person who makes fewer mistakes and does not usually forget, since none is free from both deficits. We all, you know, forget. Nah? We all make mistakes. But this is, it depends on the person. It's not his, you know, he was known by this. Uprightness, this is what we call it, al-adala. Na'am, al-adala, wa al-taqwa, that means he's a straightful person. Speaking of the term, uprightness refers to one's righteousness and moderateness, whatever one say or does. What proves that uprightness is one of the conditions of testimony, this mentioned in the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jalla said, from those whom you accept as witness. مِمَّنْ تَرْضَوْنَ تَرْضَوْنَ, that means you are pleased or you accept what they are saying. And bring witness to just men. Also, this is another ayah. All in Surah, the first one Surah Al-Baqarah, the second one Surah Al-Talaq. So the majority of Muslim scholars maintain that uprightness is an unconditional characteristic to being a Muslim and just. Okay, I think this is clear. Al-Imam Ibn Qayyim here, Ibn Taymiyyah, he talk about uprightness and all this. We'll pass this. Al-Fuqaha maintain that one's uprightness is known by two things. The first of which is performing the religious obligation. A person who doesn't pray, or if you know he leaves prayer sometimes, is this a upright person? That means he's weak, he's sinful. So this is one sign that keeping his Islamic duty, praying, fasting, giving zakah, then you say, well, this is a good man. So this is one condition, as the Sheikh said here. Like five obligatory prayers, Friday prayer, along with their stress, the testimony of the one regularly neglecting this prayer and the witr prayer, as in some ulama said, is unacceptable. Concerning the one who persists in abandoning the sunan acts, optional prayer, Al-Imam Ahmad said, such person is wicked one, for his persistence makes him non-observing the Sunnah of the Prophet. So even he's doing the obligatory prayer, because he abandoned the Sunnah of the Prophet. So how come you consider this as a righteous person according to this? There was the second one, because he said this one. The second sign by which one's uprightness is known is respectability, namely observing the good deeds and having the trace of that beauty. A person that, you know, people know him that he is just, he is nice, he is kind, naam, he's truthful, known, he's an honest, known among people by this good manner. And his neighbors always, they praise him that he's, mashallah, good neighbor. His wife is telling that he is good husband. So all these as signs give you indication about the, because many people, my dear brothers, many people, maybe they look very nice, they beautify themselves when they are in front of strangers, others, right or not? But when it's come to their own people, like their wives, their children, you will discover the right manner of this person. This is why, you know, unfortunately nowadays, you see many people, in front of the public, mashallah, you say, mashallah, this man, his wife or his family are blessed with this person. Because he's dealing with people with different. When he go home or deal with his neighbors or others who are very relatives or close, you will see him in different mood that you wish that you didn't know him. Subhanallah. This is why the Prophet ﷺ said, look to the, here the thermometer, the sign. خيركم خيركم له to whom? لأهله. The best among you are the best for their family, their wives. Because your wife is living with you. She is, you cannot hide anything. Also, like for example, Umar radiallahu anhu, one time he was asked a person for testimony. One person, he came to testifying for another person. He asked him, do you know him? He said, yes, I know him. Then he asked him, did you travel with him? He said, no. Is he your neighbor? He said, no. Did you deal with him in money? Make business with him? He said, no. Umar said, then you don't know him. Why Umar asked this question? Because when you travel for a few days, maybe you will try, for the first day, the second day, few hours. But then you cannot hide your personality, your character. Also, if you use your neighbor, you will know him. Or you deal with him, because people, when it's come to a matter of money, they forget all the ethics they claim. And they think because they love money. And this is why, subhanAllah, so this is the other sign. Okay. طيب, here we'll talk about some testimony of the following is legally unacceptable. Okay, we'll say this after the adhan, inshallah. لا إله إلا الله محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إنك حميد مجيد وعلى طيب. There are certain situation or certain people that their testimony will not be accepted, and you will notice, subhanallah, because يعني here you notice that Islam take the consideration of a human being, the nature of a human being, and his emotion, because sometimes the people were will be affected by their emotion. A person testifying among those that their testimony are not accepted, a person testifying in favor, look, in favor of his parents and forefathers, grandfathers, and on up an ascendant line, or favor of his offspring, like his children, and on down and descending line, like his children, grandchildren, grandchildren. So this person will not be, his testimony will not be accepted, either for lineage up or down. Why? Because there's some benefit, maybe they are very, very close to him. This is because one's testimony then is doubtful due to being a relative of the litigant on testify. However, testimony is acceptable from a brother for his brother. So, brother for his brother is accepted. Subhanallah, if you notice this, as we always say, look to the general picture or the whole system in Islam. Because when it's a matter of wealth, for example, the father or the grandfather, he can get some share of the inheritance or not? The same thing, right? The same thing for whom? For the children. They may get some for spouse. So there is some benefit that he may get. No? But here, for brothers, and this is why spending, and those people that you spend on them, that you are required to spend, those are your dependent. But for your brother, you can give him from his zakah, from your zakah. Your brother, if he's in need, you can give him from your zakah. But for your child, you should what? Spend on him, and you should not give him from the zakah. You see that? So this is why, subhanallah. So, طيب. Also friend for his friend, according to the general meaning of the verses related to an issue, and since testimony then is not doubted. طيب. The testimony of spouse for the other, husband for his wife, or the wife for her husband, is an exception, for each of them is already obtaining benefit from other's property. And also because of the close relationship combining both. All this makes their testimony in favor of each other doubtful. However, testimony at the same time is acceptable against one's spouse in consideration to what Allah Azza wa Jal said. If it was against, it will be accepted. But if it was for, it will not be accepted. Why? Because it is unlikely that somebody will testify against his father, right or not? Or his wife, or unless there is a reason. Allah Azza wa Jal, look to this verse, subhanAllah. This verse to show you that no other religion, no other lawgiver, and we know that the one who have the right to give law is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is our belief. طيب. But when we talk about laws in other country or other philosophy or whatever, or other communities, which is not Islamic, you will not find like this instruction. قال عز وجل وَأَقِيمُ الشَّهَادَةَ طيب وَأَقِيمُ الشَّهَادَةَ لِلَّهِ وَلَوْ كَانَتْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوْ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَالْأَقْرَبِينَ. Look to the meaning. Be persistently standing firm in justice, witnesses for Allah, for the sake of Allah, even if it be against yourself or parents and relatives. Can you find an adilu will tell you this? Subhanallah. This is the justice of Allah. That is to say, if one testify against one's parents, child, wife, or later testify against her husband, the testimony in this case will be what? Accepted, acceptable. Testimony of person that may get him some benefits or spare him some harm is unacceptable. Like, you know, a worker testify for his boss. When they go to him and say, yes, I have witness. Okay, what's your relation to him? He said, he's my boss. Now, this man will not be, his testimony will not be accepted. Why? because either he is expecting some benefits or he afraid that if he didn't say what he want, he will fire him. So Allah Azza wa Jalla, subhanallah, the Sharia, you know, get him out of this situation that he may lie. So when he go there, say, no, this will not be accepted. So he, alhamdulillah, I don't have to say something that I'm not satisfied with. The testimony of a person against his enemy is unacceptable. What do you accept from the enemies? SubhanAllah. طيب. In this regard, Ibn al-Qayyim said, and we'll finish with this, the Sharia has decreed that testimony is unacceptable when borne by someone against his or her enemy, lest testimony be used as pretext to gain benefits or avenge oneself from one's enemy through theology. So this is the point here, that either that some people, they will take revenge from their enemy by giving false testimony, or maybe he benefit himself by taking something which is not belong to him. Animosity which renders one's testimony is unacceptable is the case of being happy when another person is in diversity or sorrow, or in happy or unhappy when he is in prosperity or joy. It is worth maintaining that this means there is a worldly one, unlike animosity in religion. Anyway, all this explaining to the point that we already discussed. I think we should stop here. Will you mark this? It will be in page 737. Under the number of witness differ according to the case or issue testify in. Inshallah, this we'll discuss it inshallah next week at the same time. Barakallah feekum. See you inshallah next week. We have to run because we have to catch the salah. Sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Jazakumullah khairan.